The information featured in this program is general in nature and therefore should not be relied upon. Guests appearing on the program may have commercial arrangements with some of the companies mentioned. Before making any investment, insurance or financial planning decisions, you should consult a licensed professional who can advise whether your decision is appropriate for you.
Good evening and welcome to your Monday night property edition of Your Money, Your Call. I'm Michael Teys and I'm a bit croaky tonight, but nevertheless happy to be here. And with me are two of our favourite regulars, Damian Collins from Momentum Wealth and Nol Petrohelos from BMT Tax Depreciation. We're here to answer your questions and get your comments about our headline topics. So get to the phones and call us right now on 1300 30 34 35 or email us at property@skynews.com.au. Well, gentlemen, welcome to the program.
Hi, Michael.
Nol, continuing from some of the discussions that Margaret and Lisa have been having in the last couple of weeks, it's the new financial year,
yep.
And at this time of year, people often have problems and confusion about your particular area, and that is depreciation of property.
Yeah.
What are the sort of things you're helping people with right now?
Well, the financial year is funny because as it leads into the end of the financial year, coming up to June, we have this mad rush of people ordering depreciation schedules because they really want to pay for that report and get that money back in their pocket straight away.
I bet you hate that.
Well, you know, it's funny because, you know, there's the pay-as-you-go withholding variation. You know, the savvy investor these days will get a depreciation schedule straight away as soon as they buy the property, go and submit their or adjust their pay-as-you-go withholding variation and adjust their fortnightly take-home salary. So basically their accountant submits an amount and their employer holds a little bit less based on the deductions that they're going to get at the end of the financial year.
So the first lesson, get the report immediately, get the tax benefit immediately.
Definitely.
Don't leave it to 30 June.
Yeah, look, you manage your cash flow throughout the year, I think, is the way to go. You can, you know, if you're not good with savings and you see your tax return as a forced saving option, then definitely wait till the end of the financial year to get your depreciation schedule and to go do your tax return. But really, a dollar today is worth more than a dollar tomorrow. You've got money in your pocket that you can then reinvest, pay down a little bit of debt. It's that lost opportunity, really, that people make the mistake, wait till the end of the financial year or just before the end of the financial year to order their depreciation schedule, and people still do it, and we're out there educating people all the time about different ways they can do that, but they still tend to make that mistake. So there is that mad rush leading right up to June 30, and then it sort of stops. We get the eye of the storm, we call it, for about a week, and then as we go into around this time, mid-July, right through to October is when most Australians will be doing their tax return. Of course, they're visiting their accountants. We work very closely with accountants, so a lot of those referrals are coming through, and that's where we start seeing some of the points, the confusion points coming up. And another big one that we see often is the my property's too old. You know, people, I guess, because there's two parts to depreciation, there's the deduction available for the building write-off, which is the structural element of the building, and the deduction that's available for the plant and equipment. So that's all your carpets, blinds, light fittings, stove, hot water system, those kind of things. People tend to confuse those rules. Now, with the structural element of the building and the building write-off component, it's the wear and tear on the bricks, the roof, and what the ATO deemed to be part of the structure or permanently fixed to the building. It is governed by age, so anything older than 1987 for residential property doesn't actually get that, and 1982 for commercial properties. Mm. The plant and equipment, on the other hand, regardless of age, there's a second-hand fair market value can be put on those assets, and they can depreciate over time. So we find even, you know, 50, 60-year-old properties still get, you know, a substantial...
There's still some juice there.
There's still some juice there. And look, even if it's, you know, sometimes you might get an old property that's had absolutely nothing done to it, you know, If you've got a 60 or 70 year old property, the kitchen's not 60 or 70 years old. Usually, it'd be completely falling to pieces and maybe not, maybe uninhabitable. But you know, usually we'll see a little bit of work done. But sometimes there's absolutely nothing, you know. But the carpets will be still there. There'll be some blinds. There'll be some light fittings. Every house has a hot water system, a stove. We can put a value on those assets, and we're often surprised by what we can get out of it. And you know. I've seen 60, 70, 80 year old properties in their first year get, you know, $4,000 or $5,000 as a deduction. And on a 37% tax bracket, that's still, you know, $1,500, $1,800 back in their pocket. So it pays for the tax deductible report and puts money back in their pocket straight away. Then they've got year two, year three, year four, and so on. So yeah, we still see those little bits rearing their heads this time of year.
Damian, you're one of those accountants that...
Reformed accountant, yes.
You're a recovering accountant. Tell me about your experiences at this time of year with your clients and you know, what you're getting people to do.
Yeah. Well, look, we certainly get our clients to get depreciation reports on every investment property and when we actually acquire it. No, we don't do a mad rush at the 30 June end of year. Yeah. What we do see sometimes this time of year in our finance division is people looking for perhaps prepaying a bit of interest. Well, I've got to say that's tapered off a bit this year just with rates so low. Yeah. Haven't seen as people wanting to do that and claiming their tax deductions as much as previously, but that's a common thing we do. A lot of people also think, oh, I'll put off a buying decision until the next financial year. Well, it doesn't really matter from a income tax point of view. Obviously, you're going to start getting the deductions when it settles, and you're starting to have rental income and expenses and so forth. And from a capital gains, it won't really matter as long as you hold it for longer than 12 months. So, from our point of view, apart from the prepaid interest, there's not a huge amount towards the end of the financial year.
Now, you're a recovering accountant, but you're also from Perth.
I am.
So, tell us what's happening over there, and tell the viewers a bit about the nature of your business and what you do there.
Yeah. So Momentum Wealth, we're a property investment advisory firm. We help the clients with the property investment strategy, where to buy, what to do, and then arrange the finance. And we have a buyer's agency division as well as and manage the property. If it's in Perth, if it's out of Perth, we get other people to manage the client's property. So look, a lot of our clients are certainly looking interstate. We've been doing a bit of work in Brisbane for a number of clients. Okay. But we still think over the... If you're invested in property for a 10-year time period, Perth and Brisbane are still our two favourite cities. Mm. I think Sydney and Melbourne will do okay still, but
a bit complicated.
We look at the factors that are going to drive it. Yes, they're certainly more volatile, Perth particularly, and Brisbane. We're just in that down part of the cycle at the moment. But, you know, strangely, people think that the end of the world's coming in Perth. Well, actually, they're still employing lots of people, Rio, BHP. The shareholders are taking a bigger hit because iron ore prices have come down. Mm. Yes, there's been some cost cutting, but we're finding on the rare occasions where clients lose jobs, they're picking them up, except the engineering sector. That's the one that's really got hit.
That is hurting.
But generally in the mining, on-site stuff, there's still plenty of work around.
Okay, good. Well, we'll talk a little more about Sydney in Melbourne later in the show, but we've got our first caller on the line. Colin, you're calling about Port Macquarie, I understand.
Yeah, thanks guys for taking me call. Yeah.
Not at all.
What do you guys you think on the Port Macquarie area? Do you think it's stagnated or it's getting loose ahead or
why are can I ask why you're looking there, Colin?
Just property wise, is it worth buying there?
All right, good. Okay, well, Nol, why don't you start us off on your thoughts on Port Macquarie?
Port Macquarie is a beautiful town, and what happens at Port Macquarie, I think, is people go there for a holiday, and it's got the most beautiful beaches and the most beautiful harbour. It's a great place to live. And look, as a place to invest, I'm not saying there's anything wrong with that, but just be careful getting mixed up with that holiday dream. I know it does feed off the Sydney economy because it is a holiday town, and it had a really good run back in the around 2005 sort of area, from probably 2003 through to 2005, and then when we went into the global financial crisis in 2008, and Sydney really started to go into the doldrums, it really got hurt by that and didn't do a whole heap for a period of time. I pass through Port Macquarie quite often and stop there because my wife's family live in Coffs Harbour and it's on the way. Beautiful place. It is growing, but it's sort of the place that's just going to tick away over time, I think. And as you know, Sydney's had a great couple of years, and I think a little bit of the ripple effect from that, you might see a little bit of growth over the short term, but I think it's one of those places that's just going to slowly poke away as an investor.
It's always had the benefit of being an independent seat, or it's been an independent seat, and it's had the benefit of some rather largesse spending from governments and from time to time as well.
So yeah, okay, yeah.
That sort of helped it along. Damien, have you had any experience in the area?
Not particularly with Port Macquarie, but certainly, Colin, what I find is in our research, yeah, when the major cities start to take off, as we've seen in Sydney, then the holiday home market does certainly start to pick up. What you find is people start to feel a lot wealthier. They decide they're going to go and get a holiday property for long weekends. But the downside of that is when the market's off again, they're one of the first things to go, or if people get into some financial difficulty or interest rates go up. So, look, I wouldn't be investing generally in a holiday town. I want to know what the strong industries are that's going to keep Port Macquarie going. So you need to do a fair bit of research on that, I'd say, Colin. See what the industries are. Are they sustainable? Are they high paying? Are they going to draw more people to that town? If not, then I wouldn't be taking a punt on it.
Yeah. I always get interested in why people sort of say, what do you think about this place? Rather than approaching it the other way of, you know, where should I, a more open-ended question. And that comes, I guess, from familiarity. You know, we've got a friend or someone else has been there, or we went there and we thought it was a nice place, or is that emotional sort of side to it, isn't there?
There is, and look, there's about 14,000 suburbs around, or locations around Australia, and often people, because there's so much, they make choices on emotion, and buying property is not the way to go.
You should never buy property when you're on holiday, should you?
No,
ever.
Definitely
ever.
I've come across the odd person, and me included. You do fall in love with a place while you're on holidays, and you think I want to invest in this place and support it. And you know, sometimes it does work out, but as Damian said, you've got to look at the bigger picture. What the drivers are, who's going to pay the bills, who's employing in that area.
I call it the second Tuesday syndrome.
Yeah.
So I always reckon it's the second Tuesday of the holiday when you're just over the kids. You haven't spent that much time with your wife since last holiday, and you just need a break. So you get out and you go for a stroll and you start looking at real estate and you think that's a good idea. And that's when you come undone.
And you're in the middle of summer.
It's always the second Tuesday.
Yeah, in the middle of summer, and you think, wow, this place is booming.
Yeah, this is terrific. Yeah, I can't miss.
But Port Macquarie is a beautiful little town, I will say, and we do a few depreciation schedules there. So there is a bit of investment stock around.
All right, good. Well, thanks for tuning in, and don't forget that this week, like always, we'll be continuing with our question of the week, and this is your chance to get hold of a copy of one of Margaret's books. Each Monday night, the panel and I choose one question from either the emails or the calls and send a copy of Margaret's brand new book, How to Achieve Property Success. And if you're already an investor, this book will make sure that you cover every single part of the process. All you have to do is call us on 1300 30 34 35 or email property@skynews.com.au with a question, and make sure you're watching at the end of the show to see if you're our lucky winner. Well, it's time now for us to take a short break, but don't go away. When we come back, we'll take many of your calls and answer more of your questions. Welcome back, and thanks for joining me for the new extended format of Your Money, Your Call. I'm Michael Teys, and joining me tonight is Damian Collins from Momentum Wealth and Nol Petrohelos from BMT Tax Depreciation. So don't waste any time. Call us now on 13... Someone's calling right now on 1300 30 34 35. Or, of course, you can email us on property@skynews.com.au. Now, Damian, you're... in your capacity as an investment wealth manager for people, you cause some property syndicates to occur and to undertake some development. Yep. I'd like to talk a little bit about that tonight and how that works for private investors who might not otherwise be able to access property developments or commercial property. Yep. This is a way for them to get in for smaller sums of money.
Definitely.
Can you just tell us how that works?
Yeah, so for most developments of any scale, particularly in the larger cities, generally you're looking at a couple of million dollars as a bare minimum. And in some cases, a development can be up to 100 million or even more. And same with, I guess, commercial investment property. Trying to find something that's a half-decent investment, you don't really get it at the small end. It's typically you've got to be in that 3 to 5 minimum, yeah, billion minimum. Yeah. And so for most people, they just simply don't have that amount of money sitting around. And not only that, it's a huge risk for someone to put all their eggs potentially in that one basket of one commercial property. Certainly, I've got individual commercial properties myself, and they've been good investments, but if that was the only investment I had, that one property, I had one property vacant for 18 months at one stage. Now, I had other properties, so it was okay. But if that's, as an investor...
If that's everything you've got,
exactly,
you're in a lot of trouble.
Yeah, that's the downside with commercial properties, that bigger, much bigger vacancy risk. You can't always lease the properties out. So the opportunity in a syndication is basically people pool their money. Now, obviously, it needs to be make sure it's compliant with the financial services laws. So you need, if it's a retail one, you need a responsible entity.
So what's a retail offer?
Yep. Retail offer is an offer to the general public where you're basically they're not sophisticated or wholesale investors. So means that anybody can invest in that particular...
And what sort of investment sums typically put into a retail syndicate?
Yeah, generally 25 is the minimum. Some of the funds are minimum 50,000. So generally they're not often, unless they're through financial planning channels, generally they're not sort of $5,000 type investments. They're generally looking for 25 to 50,000.
Okay.
And a lot of people tend to use their super funds. They've got, you know, particularly if they're in their 40s and 50s and they've got a bit of money sitting around there, and if they've got a self-managed fund, they often use those. So
when you invest in a syndicate like this, you're putting your cash in.
Yep.
The debt is already in the syndicate, is it? You don't sort of, you're not borrowing as well to put in.
No. So most likely you're going to have that as cash sitting aside somewhere in, either in your own name or in your super fund. So typically they're done as unit trust, depending on what the ultimate outcome is. If it's a commercial investment property for passive long-term hold, generally they're set up as unit trust. So the money, all the distributions pass out through to the unit holders in proportion to the units they hold, and that's done, and then they're taxed in the hands of the unit holder. So the unit trust itself doesn't pay any tax. Mm-hmm. Developments can go either way, depending. They can be done as unit trust developments to sell. Yeah. They can either be done often as unit trust, or sometimes they're done as companies, but the preferred option generally is a unit trust where still it's a taxable profit, but in the unit holder's hands, and they can set up their own structures, whether it be their own name or discretionary trust to suit their own particular circumstances.
Right. And so if you're the promoter of one of these schemes, yep, where's the development profit go?
Yep.
Is it going to go to you? Or does it go to the investors?
Well, typically a promoter of a scheme or someone setting those up will be paid some sort of fees for arranging that. So in the case of what we do, you know, we have a buyer's agency and we've also got a project management division. So we're paid fees for those services that we provide to the syndicate.
Yep.
I guess the syndicate members are developers, and that's the... If it's a development syndicate. But the good thing is, as you were mentioning before, the debt is non-recourse to the unit holders. So
you're only up for what you put on the table.
Exactly. You're not. Whereas if you're developing,
you can't be chased for any disaster.
No. And of course, that means generally the banks, in order to do that, will want lower loan-to-value ratios, which keeps it a bit more conservative gearing, whereas you know, some developers try to gear up and borrow as much as possible.
Yeah.
Because of the fact that it's non-recourse back to the unit holders, then you find that there's a bit more capital. So yes, you're only up for what you've put in. If it happened to go pear-shaped or belly up, there's non-recourse to the unit holders.
So the $64 million question is, what's the rate of return on a development syndicate?
Mm.
And what's the rate of return on, a commercial property syndicate?
Yeah. Look, on a typical development syndicate that's out in the market, you'd expect to get more than 20% per annum. So on your capital invested, so if it was a 2.5-year project, you'd be looking at projects with, you know, 50%+ returns.
Mm-hmm.
They sort of start at 15% to 20%. Ultimately, though, it comes down to the performance
risk
of the...
And it's a risk return.
Absolutely.
Thing.
So it's not... Yeah, you get 2% in the bank, you get maybe 15 to 20% on these, but there's no guarantee with it. Now, on a commercial investment property, it tends to be more a passive investment, so it's around about 8% often. That's about the going rate in the market for a commercial property, and that tends to be more stable because It's a cash return as well every quarter. So you're getting every quarter, you're getting effectively 2% roughly, and that should increase over time depending on the lease terms with the commercial tenant. But the development one, you won't get a return generally right till the end till all the units are sold.
You won't.
The banks take their money first, unit holders get paid last.
Strange, isn't it?
It's strange, yeah. Terrible, isn't it? But that's what they do.
I love the banks.
No. On a commercial property syndicate, are there tax benefits there for investors? How does that work?
Definitely. Depending on the vehicle that's holding the property, the vehicle obviously has to have a tax problem, so it's obviously making money, and we can use depreciation to offset that, along with other expenses like interest and whatever else. The rules are a little bit different for depreciation around commercial buildings, and little things like, well, I mentioned before, the structural element of the building for commercial, that date is 1982. So that's when a lot of that came in. Commercial buildings are built in a unique manner, whereas a residential property, they use a very systematic building style for a typical, single-storey house, apartment blocks, two-storey house and bits and pieces. So the estimating and coming up with that base cost is a little bit more work in it for BMT. But that, it still works out to be very similar, around the 2.5%. Some commercial buildings do get 4% building write-off, so a little bit higher or accelerated building write-off over a shorter period of time.
And whatever tax benefits there are to investors in these commercial property syndicates just gets trickled down to the investors, proportionate to their investment, does it?
It really does depend on how they're holding and how that vehicle's set up. If it's a company, then sometimes the return's done for the vehicle holding, like the company. And
then the unit trust would flow through.
And the unit trust would flow through, beneficiary.
There's another option for our viewers. If they're tired of investing in residential property and want to try something a little different, a development syndicate or a commercial property syndicate is another way of accessing a different type of return and giving some diversity to a portfolio. Yeah. We talk all the time about investing in different residential zones. There's also the prospect of investing in a different type of property altogether, a commercial property or a residential development, which is really a commercial undertaking, not so much residential property itself. So that's something for people to think about, but always make sure that they're compliant. These are heavily regulated investments, and unless they're coming with an ASIC compliant document, people shouldn't touch them.
Yeah, absolutely. You've got to read the product disclosure statement, make sure you understand it, or go and seek appropriate advice. And just be, understanding that you're not, there is a manager in place, so you don't get rights to make decisions generally, unless the unit holders all got together and chose to change the manager. Generally, as a unit holder, it's a passive investment, so you can have confidence in the managers who are running it.
Yes. Now, would you say the predominant number of investors in these schemes are self-managed super funds these days? Seems to me to be ideal for a self-managed super fund, when the criticism of self-managed super funds investing in property is usually that it's too big an investment.
Yeah.
If they're buying a whole unit or a whole house, this seems to me to be perfect.
Definitely, we do see a lot of self-managed super funds because for a lot of people, that's their biggest source of wealth outside the family home, particularly if they haven't bought investment property before.
Yeah.
So there's certainly a lot of people, particularly in that 45 plus age bracket, who have quite substantial balances in their funds. So we do find that they invest in them quite a bit. The only, of course, downside of that a super fund is that it's basically for people in that 45 and under bracket is the money's stuck in there, but you can't get it out until to at least 60. But for people a bit older, those rules weren't in place, so they can get access their money in the super fund earlier.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, that's good. I think it's time for a short break. We've got a lot more to talk about, and I hope you'll stay with us. If you've got a question, call us now on 1300 30 34 35. We'd love to hear from you. We can answer questions about tax, depreciation, and any form of property investment, and my particular area, strata title property. So email us at property@skynews.com.au. You never know, you could also be the winner of the question of the week. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Your Money, Your Call. I'm Michael Teys, and if you're just watching tonight, After a couple of weeks, you'll know that we have a new format. We air now for an hour and a half to give you more time to join in the discussion. Tonight, Damian Collins from Momentum Wealth and Nol Petrohelos from BMT Tax Depreciation are here and ready to help you. So call us now on 1300 30 34 35 to join the queue, or email us on property@skynews.com.au. Well, first in the queue at the moment is Joel. And Joel, you've got a question for us.
Hi, Michael. Thanks for taking my call and panel. I listen and watch the show every week on podcast or on Foxtel. It's great and really informative, so I appreciate it.
Thank you. It's good to hear.
Now, Michael, it might take a little bit of a long-winded question. Just regarding offset accounts, mm-hmm. I've just finished a three-lot subdivision, mm-hmm. and I've actually sold two of the properties, and I'm retaining one. Mm-hmm. The settlement's coming through later this month and early next month, and the investment debt will just be retained on that third property that I'm retaining there, mm-hmm. as a full investment debt. The settlements that will come through will actually clear my principal place of residence debt, and also have a retained amount of funds sitting in the offset account. I was just wondering, in terms of that offset money, whether I can use that to offset the interest on the investment debt. I know I've read a lot of Margaret's books. She sort of says you've got to be careful about having funds sitting against investment debt because it makes them non-tax deductible. Eventually, we're actually looking to purchase a new principal place and upgrade shortly, so I'm going to be using those offset funds and also selling down the principal place of residence and upgrading. However, just for the few months, I was sort of thinking, rather than sitting in a cash-bearing account, have it offsetting some higher debt, which is the investment debt.
All right. Well, that's very detailed, but Damien, we're always careful to say at this point we're not giving financial advice on this program, so we're talking generically tonight about the matters that Joel's raised about the use of offset accounts. How would you advise someone to use something in those circumstances?
Joel, yes, so obviously we're not across everything in your personal circumstances, so it's not personal advice, but generally offset accounts are best used on non-deductible debt. You want to be making sure that because that's obviously costing you most out of pocket. Now, you're in a good situation, based on what you said there, that you actually won't have any more non-deductible debt. So in those cases, we use offset accounts for our clients against the investment debt. If they ever think that they're going to use it potentially for personal use again. Now, you mentioned there that you're going to look at buying another principal place of residence, and you might want to use some of that cash. So I would, I'd be looking at you certainly, again, potentially using that, putting that money in an offset account, and so there's no reason why you can't do that.
Okay, great. All right, well, Joel, I hope that helps. Thanks for calling. Now, we've got Steve on the line. Steve, are you there?
Yeah, hi, Michael. Thanks for taking my call.
You're welcome. How are you?
Good, good. Michael, just was listening to your conversation about depreciation earlier on in the show. Mm. I've got an old property that I've had for about 20 years, and I had tenants move out there beginning of May, mm-hmm. and I had a month to leave, and I used the opportunity to put a new kitchen in. I've re-gyprocked it, gutted a lot of the rooms and put new gyproc up, mm-hmm. electrical fittings, and basically just try and do some value-adding.
Mm-hmm. And you did that after the tenants had moved out?
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. So I've spent about $15,000. I've done a lot of the work myself, mm-hmm. Plus used some subcontractors. Now, probably until tonight, I was just thinking about, and I've got about another $5,000 worth of work to go, mm. that I'm hoping to do. I was just going to basically take those receipts to my account and just sort of basically claim them. But listening to your guest earlier, as I said, I spent about $15,000, but I think if I would have got a builder or something in to do it, it would have cost me probably a lot more than that. Mm. So am I better off getting a depreciation report before I go to my accountant, or...?
All right. Well, let's see what Noel's got to say on that.
Hi, Steve. Thanks for the question. Look, we have to use actual costs when they're available. It's unfortunately, there's a couple of individual rulings on this, and although you've put your own time in, we still, like, there is an actual cost there available, and we have to use them. So we just need to look at that $20,000. So the main role that we'll play here is trying to get, I'd still recommend getting a quantity surveyor to have a look, purely because a quantity surveyor is a specialist cost, and they're going to go in and try and get as much of that $20,000 written off as quick as possible. The more plant and equipment that we can load into that $20,000, the higher the deductions are going to be earlier on. Another thing you probably should have done that may be a little bit too late now is I'm not sure whether you had an existing depreciation schedule. You have held the property for 20 years, so there wouldn't be a whole heap left on those particular assets within the property. But if there's another scenario where you're doing a renovation that you've only held the property for a few years, you really should look at getting a depreciation schedule done before you do the renovation, because all those assets that you're ripping out, whether it be old carpet, old blinds, old light fittings, old kitchen stoves, or even the kitchen cupboards, if that part of the building qualifies, because you've scrapped those assets and they become a loss, the whole value of those assets become an immediate deduction. So often, on an old property, we might come up with $10,000 or $15,000 worth of old assets that are being ripped out and scrapped. So long as the building was producing income before you do that, you can actually claim that as a loss, and then start to depreciate the new assets that come in. So it's like a double whammy, a double deduction available. So that's something to think about. Will it go over the $20,000? No, that's the cost to you, and unfortunately the tax office are quite strict on that. We have to stick to that cost, but we will try to break up the assets to get to accelerate that depreciation as quick as we can, especially in that first five years.
It's not only about the dollar sum, it's about the timing.
It's about the timing, definitely.
All right, good.
Yeah.
Well, a lot of good information there for Steve, so hopefully that helps make the most of that work that he's done in that break. All right, we'll take our first email tonight from Mark. And Mark asks, I live in Sydney, but I'm looking for a Brisbane property. I've looked into the inner city of Brisbane, but it looks oversupplied in the unit market. Do you have any suburbs in Brisbane that you think could have good growth rates going forward for houses? I'm going to use my self-managed super fund and I'm prepared to buy up to $600,000. I have a commercial property within the self-managed super fund that has already been paid off and is rented to my business, so there is plenty of cash flow to service any loan. All right, gentlemen, well, what do we make of this situation? A few things there. A self-managed super fund, a lot of money, $600,000.
Yeah.
Advice? Noel, start with you.
Look, I'm a depreciation guy. I'm not really a location guy, but I am an investor myself, and I do keep an eye on Brisbane. And I think Queensland and Brisbane and sort of the outer ring of Brisbane is it's had it's sort of picked up in the last 12 months, but I think it's still got a bit to go. And probably as an area a little bit, Sydney, we've seen a lot of action in the last 2-3 years, Melbourne very similar, whereas Brisbane not as much, and I think it's sort of gaining some momentum now. I really like a little bit north, Chermside, close to the airport. There's some big shopping centres, a lot of infrastructure going on there, or down through the Brisbane to Gold Coast corridor, right down from Logan.
Louis Christopher was talking about that on Peter's show just before this one, and that's always been a corridor of
big growth corridor,
enormous potential, affordable houses, lots of jobs, the option of working in one city or the other.
Yep.
Different as chalk and cheese, Gold Coast and Brisbane, but there they are in close proximity to one another. Plenty of choice for people in that area.
And what I would say is just to think outside the square a little bit and don't look at one place for $600,000, potentially diversify a little bit.
That was what I was thinking. I mean, $600,000, you could really do a lot with $200,000-$300,000 investments still, couldn't you?
Yeah. He did mention he wanted that. He was interested in a house, which we'd probably struggle unless you went out to the far flungs of Brisbane. But
I reckon I could convert him to a unit person myself.
Well,
I'm pretty good.
Mark did say he did notice there's an oversupply of units, which definitely there is in the
city. There's no doubt about that.
City area,
absolutely no doubt.
That's always
about
one
that.
Of the things. I'm always hesitant when I, as an investor, and when we're advising clients, if someone can put a lot more of it out there, which is often happens in the city. I was just down in Melbourne this morning, and the Docklands and South Bank, plenty of apartments all through that coming on, and that's always the risk. So I would definitely steer clear of the apartment market in the inner city. Yeah. Some of the areas we'd also like, Chermside, that's an area we've been buying for clients. It's one of the strategic metropolitan areas that is in the Brisbane plan. Also on the a bit further on the east side, Nunda is a good one. It's on the train line. And Mitchelton on the other side is, again, got good transport.
Everton Park?
Oh, in that same sort of
same
vicinity.
Same sort of zone,
in that area. Look, what I'm finding in our research shows that Sydney and Melbourne particularly, because they're much they're bigger cities, and the premium people pay to be close to public transport increases as the city gets bigger and denser.
Yes.
And we haven't seen that quite as much in Perth and Brisbane.
No.
And they're both 2 million cities looking to grow to 4 or 5 million over the next 30 years.
Yeah.
So I think in those cities, we certainly favour being in good proximity to public transport, because as the cities get more congested and denser, people will pay those premiums to be close to train stations. So they're our tips. And I think I'm with Nol. I think Brisbane is probably the best set market in the next couple of years. Now, you don't want to just buy in the next 3 years, but because often if it's an area that can only have 3 years growth, that's not enough. You want to be looking at 10 years, but I still like Brisbane 10 years as well as three. So that would be our top pick. And I think the market is heating up, though. There's quite a bit of activity. We're buying for clients there. We do often get outbid. So you've got to be, I'd recommend, getting a buyer's agent to help him, particularly if he lives in Sydney. He's going to struggle to buy, particularly when he's in a remote location.
And a buyer's agent is going to charge, obviously, the buyer a fee.
Yes, definitely.
But is that going to be worth it, not just in terms of time, but also in getting a better price?
Well, definitely. Certainly, negotiation. A buyer's agent can add value there. Certainly, they'll hopefully be more in tune with the market and the agents. We find that selling agents like to share a bit more information than with a fellow agent as a buyer's agent than they would necessarily with someone directly. But it's also choosing the right areas. So we've mentioned a few suburbs tonight, but if you're going to go into another city and you don't know it, how are you going to choose the best areas? We've certainly in our office spent hundreds and hundreds of hours researching the Brisbane market. So if someone going to another city, you're certainly taking a big risk by doing that without having someone on the ground who actually knows the market and knows what to do. So I would certainly recommend anyone going interstate, not in their own town, would be worth using a buyer's agent.
I'd just say in relation to our last question that probably need to be a little bit careful with the self-managed super fund having such an exposure to property.
Mm.
There's a commercial, unencumbered commercial property there, and looking at a $600,000, we of course don't know the size of the self-managed super fund, but I do think we need to keep that in perspective. I also think we need to keep in perspective that government regulators, I'm certain, are going to look very carefully at how much property is going into self-managed superannuation funds. I don't think there's any concern about that being retrospective, but it certainly would be a concern, I think, to them if they were getting too heavy in property. So just be mindful of those things. All right, well, thanks for tuning in. It's time we took a short break so I can have a bit of a cough. But when we return, you'll have another chance to get hold of a copy of Margaret's new book, How to Achieve Property Success. But you'll have to ask a question and have it selected. So simply call now on 1300 30 34 35, or you can email us on property@skynews.com.au. Welcome back to Your Money, Your Call, where we're now taking your calls and answers for the next 45 minutes. I'm Michael Teys, and joining me is Damian Collins from Momentum Wealth and Nol Petrohelos from BMT Tax Depreciation. I'm sure you also have a question for us, so grab the phone and dial 1300 30 34 35 or email us on property@skynews.com.au. Now, we have a caller on the line. Angela, how are you?
Good, thank you.
Good. How can we help you?
Hi, I have a question for the panel. I have an investment property that is managed under a body corporate. It's part of a body corporate.
Yes.
The executive committee decided to use part of the sinking funds to paint the building.
Mm-hmm.
And now to pay back the money into the sinking fund, we are paying an extra levy.
Mm-hmm.
I just want to know if that money, that extra levy that I have been paying for a year, can I claim that in depreciation?
All right, good.
Thank you.
All right, well, the body corporate, of course, raises money and puts that to a sinking fund or a capital works fund as a form of saving, so that they have money to spend on recurrent issues. But when something needs to be when it's more than repair and maintenance, when something needs to be renewed or replaced, it comes from the sinking fund. In the case of painting, I guess painting the whole of the building, Nol, that's a capital item. Does the levy therefore become deductible?
Yeah, if the individual has contributed to that painting, then that based upon their percentage of ownership, their unit entitlement usually dictates that. If their accountant deems that to be a capital improvement, then we're happy to include that in their depreciation.
Okay, so the unit of entitlement is going to be used to strike the levy.
Yes.
So it's going to be the amount.
So the portion.
The net effect is it's the amount of the levy that's going to be deductible.
That's right. And look, some special levies are raised for repairing, and therefore, they're written off as a levy, an expense, that complete amount. But if you're talking about painting a whole building, it'd be tough to say it's a repair. You're probably improving, and therefore it falls under the capital improvement or the capital works allowance. And unfortunately, painting is one of those things that the ATO deem as to be part of the structural elements of the building or fixed to the building, 2.5% per year of that. It's not a whole heap of money, That's the way to claim it, strictly speaking.
But it still makes the important point, doesn't it, that just because you're in a body corporate or a strata organisation of some sort, these rules still apply.
They do,
And there's you're an owner of the property.
That's right.
And there's money to be made out of the depreciation.
Yeah, it's what we see people miss it all the time. And you know, when we do a depreciation schedule on a unit complex, we'll go through the whole building, right from the driveway. You have a percentage of ownership over that driveway, even if there's some bollard lights on the driveway. You know, right through to a lift, gymnasium, swimming pool equipment. We'll capture as much of that as we can and include it in the depreciation schedule. Another good thing is because often the percentage of ownership is quite small, they'll qualify for some of the little depreciation, the legislation depreciation tricks that allow us to increase the rate of depreciation. And that's like a low value pool that's for assets under $1,000. It's not really the asset, it's the interest in the asset. And then there's the immediate write-off less than $300. So if their interest in that asset...
Oh, that's very interesting.
Yeah, is less than that amount, it qualifies those assets. And the same goes when you have multiple owners, you know, like a husband and wife owning a property. It's about the interest that qualifies for those particular accelerated depreciation rules.
So in a very big building, that's going to be...
On a big building, you'll see a whole heap of assets there that'll have a value of less than $1,000. All of those assets are qualifying for the low value pool and therefore written off at 37.5% rather than their normal effective life, which might be, you know, 6 or 7 or 8% based on the normal effective life.
Good. All right. Well, thanks for that. To another email, this time from Maureen and Matthew. Their email reads, "My son and I have a 3 to 4 bedroom house in Boronia Heights, Queensland, which we've held for 10 years. It's on a 660 square block and it has not appreciated greatly over that time. We're wondering if we should sell it now, renovate and sell, and purchase something else that will have more capital growth over the next 5 years. Or hold on for a few more years." All right, a sad tale.
Yeah.
A sad tale. A property held for 10 years that hasn't done much. What do we know about Boronia Heights that's caused this malaise?
Well, it's in the outer suburbs of Brisbane. It's in the southwest part of town, and Brisbane overall hasn't had a particularly strong run since 2008. The last 7 years, it's really only done CPI inflation. So overall, Brisbane hasn't performed particularly well. And again, a lot of those, I don't know if they purchased a house and land package or what they bought out there, but I'm guessing just by the sound of it, that sort of block size, that it possibly was something like that.
Yeah.
And a lot of developers and property spruikers like to push that sort of stuff out in the far flung areas, but don't always make the best investments, particularly if there's a lot of other supply coming on.
Yeah.
That's the risk. And there is, you know, certainly a supply risk around that area. It has been. That's why it hasn't done particularly well. One of the questions was, should they, you know, sell it, renovate it? Well, that's a question we can't answer because we don't know enough about what they're planning to do and what, you know, the added value might be. Certainly, if I was going to spend, you know, $20,000, I'd want to get at least add $40,000 to it. And a lot of mucking around with that, a lot of messing around, you could have a vacant
it's
property
as well. It's not generally
a
good idea, is it?
No, so look, that's possibly not going to help them. Look, I think overall, the Brisbane market's going to improve, and that's, as we said earlier in the show, that that's where we think it's going to be the best location. But I think you can do better than Boronia Heights. Obviously, you need to take into account your tax consequences. You're going to have stamp duty again, unfortunately, when you buy. But I've, you know, in our research, we've looked at it. If it only takes a few percent a year outperformance in a better location, in a couple of years, you've generally made up those costs if you don't have a big capital gains bill, which they generally won't. So I'd be looking at some of the other suburbs. But go and talk to your accountant first. Just find out what your tax bills
situation
may be.
Is, yeah. Noel, what do you think of Boronia Heights?
Well, look, Boronia Heights, as we said before, it is in that corridor that's seeing a bit of growth. But that is a sad story. They've followed all the rules. They've gone in long term, 10 years, and haven't seen a whole heap of growth. Look, it's a really difficult one. I think there's, you know, around those areas, there's growth coming. But at the same time, it hasn't had a great history. There are probably better options out there. But it's the kind of thing, me personally, I can't give a whole heap of advice on, other than that there will be costs in letting go of that property, in agent fees and transferring that through to another property. Mm-hmm. What Damian said, speak to an accountant, because there'll be, depending on your tax situation, it might be better off just letting it sit there and tick away for a little bit longer.
I think so too. I mean, if I'd bought something in Brisbane, it, as you say, hasn't had great run since 2008, you might have been sitting through the worst of it, and then just miss a little bit. It's also possible that you could look at what equity you have there and use that as security for something else rather than selling. Perhaps hold, but you know, it's a difficult one.
And depending on their situation, if they're desperate, I'd say, as Damian said, look at something else. But I agree, Michael. I'd be giving it a little bit longer.
All right, we've got time for a quick email before our next break. This comes from a person who says they're looking at buying their first property on the Central Coast at the end of the year, which will be a principal place of residence. However, I'd like to place a tenant in the property for a few years. What are your thoughts on this strategy and the Central Coast market? Let's just deal quickly with the Central Coast market. What do you say?
Oh, look, it's certainly getting the spillover effect from Sydney. As we said earlier in the show, that once the becomes too expensive to live in central CBD and even most places now in Sydney, that you certainly see that ripple effect out there. So I think the Central Coast will benefit from that over the next.
It's getting hard to get a park out there.
Is it?
I never get a park in Central Coast when I go to visit Margaret.
So terrible. Yeah.
Terrible.
So. I think as long as the city market's running strongly, that'll continue to do okay.
Yeah. Noel, what do you say about the Central Coast?
Look, exactly what Damien said, the spillover, it's in the last 12 months, it's jumped. And I think it's still got a bit to go because that spillover from Sydney. So I think it's good. And look, I really think it's a good strategy, a way to get into the property market to make your first home an investment. I think more people should be doing it. Just be careful because you're mixing two separate strategies. They're looking for a home which has a whole different set of criteria, potentially in the long term, and an investment, really you should be looking at numbers and performance of that investment and drivers in the area, what's going to push the growth of that area. And they're really two separate strategies, and you've got to be careful blurring that because you end up with a mixed outcome.
But it's often a first timer's sort of wish and desire, but they're going to outgrow that.
That's right, and as a way of getting in the market, with the investment, you've got the extra tax deductions. It's a good way to get.
I was looking at the figures of the number of people between the age of 33 and 43 that aren't owning a home at the moment, but are in the property market. It's really, really growing.
Mm. Oh.
Very, very substantial trend for us to take account of.
It is.
Well, it's now time for us to take a very short break, but when we return, you'll have another chance to ask your questions simply by calling us on 1300 30 34 35 or emailing us on property@skynews.com.au. Welcome back to Your Money, Your Call. I'm Michael Teys, and with me on the desk tonight is Damian Collins from Momentum Wealth and Nol Petrohelos from BMT Tax Depreciation. We still have time left for you to call. and get in for a comment or a question. And you may even be this week's book winner. So call now on 1300 30 34 35 or email us on property@skynews.com.au. Before we take another caller though, in news this week, the New South Wales government has surprised many in the strata sector with new legislation, all drawn up and ready to go, the major reform of which is a compulsory sale of a whole strata block if 75% agrees. This represents a major departure from the sanctity of title for residential property. Gentlemen, I was wondering about this week, and I was thinking how that's going to affect people and their perception of buying a unit as a home compared with a house with a white picket fence. Mm. What do we think about this reform?
Well, I know where you're coming from there. You talk about the sanctity of title, but even in that, we still have that...
My castle.
We still have those...
Can't take it away from me.
They can. The government can compulsorily acquire.
Yes.
And I guess in this situation, particularly when the bigger cities around Australia are getting more congested and they need higher density and more density, a lot of these old strata premises, you might have 6 or 8 or 10 units in locations where not might now be suitable for 30, 40, 50 units. And so from that perspective, I guess it's for the greater good. And what you will find, though, is that people are going to get paid more than what it's worth individually. Otherwise, it's not going to stack up no one's going to sell out. So what this is all about is, let's say your individual unit's worth, say, $800,000, but a developer wants to come along and develop it. He might be willing to pay 1.2. It's stopping that one or two holdouts in a complex from, I guess, stymieing everyone else's desire to take that and move on. So people, you may end up losing their property, but they're going to be certainly, it's not going to work, and the 75% aren't going to agree unless the market price, the price they're paid is more than market anyway. Mm. So I think ultimately, for the greater good, we do need these.
Well, what if one of those two people holding out is your mother, and she really likes living there and she doesn't want to go anywhere?
That makes the situation a lot harder, Michael, if it was my mother. Look, there are going to be people that are going to be in difficult situations here. I'm a short-term pain, long-term gain sort of person, but I'm also pro-choice, so they sort of conflict with each other.
You're very confused.
I'm a little confused. Look, I don't like seeing some of these old buildings sitting there and doing nothing, and I think a little bit of encouragement to do that is to develop and improve these buildings is a great idea. We've got housing shortage problems, supply problems, and getting good quality stock on the market should be seen as a priority for the government. But there's going to be the scenario where they've been their home their whole life, and I really don't know. It's a hard one. Mm. Overall, I'd probably tend to say I agree with it. I think that it'd be good to see a lot of those older buildings prettied up and creating that extra stock. But
look, on balance, I agree with it too. I've been a proponent of this for nearly 20 years, and I think it's a good concept. What I think the government's done particularly well with the exposure draft that we saw last week is to provide a lot of protection for people. So it's not just simply a matter of a resolution of 75% and the others are out. The resolution to 75% gets you to a status where you can then make an application to the Land and Environment Court for the plan to be proceeded with. So the Land and Environment Court is going to make sure that those that aren't in favour initially are properly looked after and respected, the tenants are looked after, that people are given adequate time and adequate notice. So I think the detail around the process is quite complex. It's not going to be an easy process for developers to pull off. We won't see a flood of them, but I think where people are determined to do it and where it makes eminent sense for the owners of the property, for the proponent of the scheme and for the urban environment, then this is a way of proceeding and giving people protection with a court overlooking the process so that people don't get treated badly. Mm. I think it can work, but it does mean that when you buy into a collectively owned property, it's not quite the same. And I think people need to take that into account when they buy. They're going to continue to buy into strata title property, frankly, because many aren't going to have any choice. It is different. Mm. And those laws are going to help, I think.
I think you're going to find, though, that they're going to be on the older style ones. They're not going to, you know, be...
Quite.
They're not likely to be
this
anything.
Is not happening in something new.
It's not likely to happen anything. It's less than 10 years old. I'd find that highly unlikely. So, overall, on balance, it's laws I think we need. But, and as you say, I don't think it's not going to happen every property. And to get that 75% to even agree, that the price would have to be pretty good to get that. Yeah. So I think...
I have seen in Sydney just in the last couple of weeks a particular building that we've been managing where a developer's come in with an extraordinary price and all of a sudden, you know, Noel's mum, she's pretty happy to be going. She's just picked up a big cheque.
She's going for the view somewhere.
She's gone. She's on a cruise. Yeah. It's been a good news story. So. There's some other reforms in that package which I think are significant as well. A 2% levy on builders and developers, which has got to go towards defects to be held over a 2-year period. Mm. I think it's good that the issue of defects is being addressed because it's terrible. There's bad defects in new buildings everywhere, particularly in Sydney. The Institute of Engineers has come out at last. Someone credible has come out and said that private certification is bad, and it's perhaps it's worse in New South Wales than anywhere. So New South Wales responding with a 2% building bond is an interesting concept. Although my concern about this is, it's actually the unit owner that's paying. The builders and the developers won't be sitting at home tonight going, oh shucks, we've just lost a couple of percent. They'll be thinking of ways to add that to the price, probably add 5% and tell the people that it was a government initiative. Consumer protection always comes at a cost to the consumer. So I think what we've really got here is a scheme where it's almost a forced savings scheme. When you buy a unit now, you're going to be putting away a bit of your own money to pay for the defects. The only way that we're going to get cultural shift on defects is to change the certification system and the way in which people are undertaking buildings. Because it's just appalling what people are serving up. I don't know whether you're seeing it in Perth, Damian, but the standard of the buildings being delivered in Sydney and Canberra at the moment is just woeful.
Yeah. Well, I think it's just a function of there's a lot of demand out there and the builders and developers are getting away with the second-rate product. But, look, I think the 2%... The problem, where I guess it goes back to, is there's no insurance in a house.
In a large building.
In a large building, there's no insurance for defects insurance. Whereas in a single house, depending which state you're in, often there's 6-year structural warranties that they have to be given. So, because they couldn't get the insurance, or it was too prohibitively expensive, they dropped it. And of course, then the second rate construction came in. It's interesting, from the proposal, it seemed to be levied on the developer. And as you say, well, the developer's not the builder, so they're just going to get passed on, and ultimately for that protection the consumers are going to pay it themselves.
That's right, and that's just the way of the world. I'm chairing a meeting tomorrow night in Sydney where people have bought into a new building. The building was worth $58 million when it was sold a year ago, and they've got a bill for defects of $15 million. $15 million. That's $100,000 a head, it's a dreadful problem. The sector can't let that continue to happen.
No,
it's an absolute disgrace.
And I guess it's just a lesson for people buying, and particularly in Sydney at the moment, where whole complexes are selling out in one day. You need to be going back and doing your home. Who's the developer? Do they have a reputation to protect? And who's the builder on these projects? Do these people have reputations that they need to protect and are going to do a good job? Because there's a lot of stuff out there. People are just buying anything and not thinking about all those things that might come to fruition in the years ahead.
All right. Well, in other news this week concerning strata, I've decided to take on 5 franchisees for my strata management business, Block Strata. So if you think you might want to be part of that, part of the fastest growing property sector there is, and certainly the way of the future, then contact me now at michael@blockstrata.com.au and I'll make sure that we get an information pack sent out to you right away. Well, we'll take an email now. We've got an email from Tom who asks, I have a super fund that myself and my wife are trustees and members of the fund. In New South Wales, this fund is up to the threshold. We also have a principal place of residence in New South Wales. If we wish to purchase another investment property in New South Wales, could this be purchased in my wife's personal name and avoid land tax, provided it is below the threshold, considering she is a trustee and member of the super fund? My wife has no taxable income. Damian, let's start with you on that one.
Tom, my understanding is that in New South Wales, and it varies across different states, is that your super fund would be treated separately to yourselves as individuals. And so in that particular case, you may get a threshold exemption. But look, it's obviously an important decision. If you get hit with potentially 1.6% tax, as it is in New South Wales, that could be another $6,000 or $7,000 a year. So I'd be going to speak to someone in the know about that, a property lawyer or a property tax accountant who's familiar with New South Wales land tax.
I think you're right on that point. Yeah. It will be different, yeah. Regarded as a different entity, and then the husband and wife can then also hold property separately. Yeah. So there's three entities there
that can
hold property. I think the question is that too much property in New South Wales? is that too much property? And if that's all the property you've got, you know, there are other options. You know, sometimes people in New South Wales forget that there are other states, quite a few of them. And it might be that there's some other investment to be had. We were talking earlier about the Sydney market and the Melbourne market. What about the rest of Australia? We've talked a little bit about Perth. Anything happening anywhere else that people need to be on?
No, I was down in Melbourne on the weekend, and that, particularly the inner eastern suburbs, is going almost like Sydney. It's very buoyant,
it's crazy,
and property's going 20-30% over reserve. Not as buoyant, still strong, but not as buoyant in when you get a bit further out. But look, I'd be avoiding Melbourne now for an investment. I think again, look, no one knows when the music is going to stop, and it's still. But one, I remember very clearly in Perth. 2007, when the music stopped, it stopped very quickly. And it doesn't take a lot, and then all of a sudden people notice no one's buying anymore, and it can happen very quickly. So I think it's going to be sometime this year in Sydney and Melbourne, but who knows the exact date. And so getting at this late stage is when people make the biggest mistakes, and they could be in the situation where I wouldn't be surprised if 2020, the prices in Sydney are much the same as, particularly in the area, particularly if you've overpaid, that you'd be in 5 years' time, you might be sitting with something that hasn't grown in value at all.
Aberonia Heights.
10 years.
Tragedy we were talking about before. Mm. All right. Well, thanks for tuning in. It's time for us to take a break. But when we return, we'll be answering more of your questions and those emails. To have them answered, simply call us now on 1300 30 34 35 or email us at property@skynews.com.au. Welcome back to Your Money, Your Call. I'm Michael Teys, and we've had a great night with our panel, Damian Collins from Momentum Wealth and Nol Petrohelos from BMT Tax Depreciation. Our lines are closed for tonight, but we have time for a question from our last caller, who I think's name is Michael. Hello, Michael. How are you?
Good, thank you.
Good. How can we help you tonight?
Yes, hi. I've got an investment property I did some renovations on in 2012 and 2013, and I didn't claim the full depreciation from it at that time. Mm-hmm. I just want to know if I can still do it now, and if I can, how do I go about it?
All right. OK, well, you've asked on the right note, because Noel's going to give us an answer to that right now, Noel.
Yes, Michael, definitely you can go back and claim that. So every time that BMT does a depreciation schedule, we actually start all schedules from the settlement date when you became the owner of that property, and we project it out. Now, a little unknown fact is that assets depreciate whether the owner claims it or not. So basically the fundamentals of depreciation are that the assets wear out over time. Now, even if you have a primary place of residence, the assets are still wearing out. You just can't claim them. So in your scenario, you've done some work. As long as the work is a capital improvement and not classified as repairs and maintenance. Now, repairs and maintenance are things that you're basically bringing back to the state that it was when you purchased. You claim that directly with your accountant as long as the building was income producing. Whereas depreciation, you're actually adding to what was there. So if you did anything in that first 12 months, it'd be difficult to claim it as repairs and maintenance. But so we'll set up the schedule to start from when you purchased. It'll calculate each year, and what you'll see in the year that you did those renovations, you'll see additional assets pop into that schedule, and the deduction down the bottom there increase because of those extra assets. So we'll backdate it. Just make sure you get to your accountant this year when you're doing your tax return and include those in there, because the tax office can be a little bit funny sometimes about going back and amending previous years. They'll usually only allow 2 years. So make sure you get it in this financial year. If there's been any special circumstances, the tax office will sometimes let you go back a little bit further, but you really need to put a bit of a case forward for that.
Okay, what sort of special circumstances might they be?
We've seen the ATO let people go back to, you know, as far as 7 or 8 years because they've been out of the country. They've been caught in some predicament outside of Australia and they couldn't actually do a tax return and they're able to go back and amend. We've had people with ill health under special circumstances. You know, they haven't done a tax return for a period of time and they're able to go back and amend. If you just call up and say, I forgot to do my depreciation, or your accountant does that, it's probably not going to cut it. You're probably going to end up only getting that 2 years, but you can get that 2 years and it's two additional years back. And they're basically amended assessments. So you're doing your current year and you're basically going back and amending those assessments from previous years, including those deductions that you missed out on. And unfortunately, we see it happening all the time, and it's purely because depreciation is one of those deductions. It's a non-cash deduction. There's no receipt, there's no money going out. It's there to be claimed. But because there's no actual paper trail for depreciation, people sometimes miss it. And unfortunately, when you're missing out, that's missed money in your pocket. And they realise they've got to do it, and then all of a sudden they're like, oh, I can't go back and claim. You know, if it's been 5, 6 years, they've missed out average depreciation schedule for residential property, somewhere between $7,000 and $12,000 per year as a deduction.
That's heartbreaking.
Yeah.
Well, Michael, it sounds like you may have called just in time. So with that advice, I'd go and see someone straight away and get that fixed up. All right, we're going to take an email now from Anne, and Anne asks, I'm building my property portfolio and would appreciate your advice on how to find an accountant proficient in property investment tax. All right,
there's one right here.
There's one here. Well,
a reformed
accountant.
Oh, that's right, he's reformed.
Accountants with expertise in property, not that common.
No, they're not, Michael. And I think it's, a lot of accountants will do, clients of all different spectres and spheres and all sorts of different businesses. And I find that in a lot of cases, if it's pretty basic sort of property tax, most accountants can do it. But, like depreciation, I'm sure Nol sees it. Some accountants probably don't even recommend depreciation reports, whereas I would certainly recommend getting them. So I think the best thing for Anne would be is you've really got to ask the questions. What is your specialty? So without going there, say, I'm a property investor. Can you help me? They'll say yes. Go in there and say, what is the areas that your firm specialises in and where you can help people? Yeah. The other thing would be to talk to other property investors and see if they've got good accountants.
I'd be talking to a property manager and saying, can you tell me where your two or three best investors are getting their accounting advice from? Because there's really, my travels around the country, you find accountants that... very focused on the share market, very focused on managed funds. Property just, it's just not their thing.
Yeah, for a lot of them, it's not necessarily their thing. And, I think you've got to get that referral. It's find out who are the people you're using, whether it's from people you know yourself who are property investors or talk to your property manager. They might be able to find out who their best clients are using as well. And, definitely a referral is probably the best place to be looking.
Yeah, all right. Well, we should also mention our good friend Ian from Bishop Collins.
Ian Rodriguez,
who I think is an excellent accountant. So there's a free plug for Ian. We're going to take another email, and this one comes from Harshal, who asks us, what do you think of investing in Brisbane's Sky Tower, located in the business district of Brisbane? It's a state-of-the-art complex, built as the tallest residential complex in Brisbane. Mm. All right, well, without wanting to rain on the parade of Sky Tower in Brisbane, I don't think we'd have much good news for the developers of that. What do you say?
No, and we were just talking earlier in the show about the looming oversupply in Brisbane, and that email sounds like he's selling it to himself, unfortunately.
Yeah, it really does, doesn't it?
It's selling it back to himself. So, look, there is a looming oversupply of apartments. Yeah. It doesn't mean that the rest of Brisbane won't grow, but those apartments are likely to underperform.
I've made a real study of these mega towers over years. Mm. Q1, Eureka, not so much. I'm going to leave Eureka out in Melbourne, but if you look at the Gold Coast, Q1, Seoul, Circle on Cavill, even big developments, and they all were built. They were left with unsold stock. Mm. The developer went broke. The receiver came in. The first thing they did is whack 25% off the price, and then another 25%.
Clear them out. Yeah.
And it's going to take people 10 years to get over that.
Yeah.
A good 10 years.
Yeah, exactly.
You and I have disagreed from time to time about whether or not the value is in the land or in a unit. But I think in the case of the mega towers, it's definitely an oversupply risk. It's a internal oversupply.
And look, with those mega towers, as you say, they're branding it. This is the tallest this or the biggest that, and they're spending exactly. They're spending a lot of marketing. They're probably charging premium prices, and they are very expensive to build as well. When you get up to certain height levels, so look, all around, I would just say, look, I think you could find better places for your money in Brisbane.
Yeah, lots better there.
One positive note: the depreciation on those mega towers are quite good, because there's lots of assets in the common areas. But they've had a bad history, I guess.
All right. Well, thanks, gentlemen. That brings us to the end of our show. Margaret will be back next week with Rich Harvey of Property Buyer and Simon Presley of Propertyology. Thank you to our panellist, Nol Petrohelos from BMT, and Damian Collins from Momentum Wealth. Always good to have you on the show, gentlemen.
Thanks, Michael.
Thanks also to our callers. And this week, the question of the week goes to Colin from Geelong. And you might recall that Colin had a question about Port Macquarie. So we hope that you enjoy Margaret's book and that it helps you on your investing way. If you could now email me, Colin, on your money, your call at destiny.com.au, I'll make sure that the book gets sent out to you. You can follow me on Twitter at Michael Teys. And don't forget that I'm looking for just 5 quality partners for my franchise strata management business in Sydney. So email me at michael@blockstrata.com.au if you think you might be the one. Thanks for being with us. I'll see you again in a few weeks.
The information featured in this program is general in nature and therefore should not be relied upon. Guests appearing on the program may have commercial arrangements with some of the companies mentioned. Before making any investment, insurance or financial planning decisions, you should consult a licensed professional who can advise whether your decision is appropriate for you.